Morning.
Morning.
Welcome to St. John's on this Memorial Day weekend Sunday. Any moments of joys or concerns?
As mentioned in the bulletin, our church picnic is coming up. We're going to do what we did last year. So on June 12th, we will have an outdoor service right out on our lawn. We will have some of those easy up tents. So if we have some harsh sun, we'll be able to sit underneath. And then please stay after for a covered dish lunch. And then you can also stay, if you'd like, for our card making as well.
If anyone is interested in supporting the local families affected by the explosion on Thursday, we'll send out today a link to the Pottstown Foundation. They have a special fund they're setting up to help support those families. Of course, I'm sure there's lots of other things going on as well, but if you're looking for some place to donate, the Pottstown Foundation for Education has set up a special fund for that. Also, Isabel graduates on Friday, and this will be her last Sunday for a while, because 2 days later she leaves to work at a camp all summer. So I'm not sure when she'll be back in church after this week. And then at the end of the summer, of course, she'll leave for college. She's going to University of Pitt at Bradford. And we'll give you her address or anything if you're interested in that later. But that's what we have for that. All right. Let us start with our prayer, please. In the call to worship. We have been invited to know God.
Let us enter the knowledge of God.
We have been invited to bear God's justice.
Let us enter justice, God.
We have been invited to enter God's truth.
Let us enter the truth of God.
We have been invited to enter God's unity.
Let us enter the unity of God.
Beautiful our spacious sun, our Put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet in the stocks.
About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was an earthquake, so violent that the foundation of the prison was shaking, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer woke up and saw the prison's doors wide open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, since he supposed that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted in a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." The jailer called for lights, and rushing in, he fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them outside and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." They spoke the word of the Lord to him, and all who were in his house. At the same hour of the night, he took them and washed their wounds. Then he and his entire family were baptized without delay. He brought them up into the house and set food before them, and he and his entire household rejoiced that he had become a believer in God. Our second lesson is from Revelation chapter 22, selected verses. "See, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, to repay according to everyone's work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes, so that we will have the right to be to the tree of life, and may enter the city by the gates. It is I, Jesus, who sent my angel to you with this testimony for the churches. I am the root of the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, 'Come.' And let everyone who hears say, 'Come.' And let everyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who wishes to take the water of life as a gift. The one who testifies to these things says, 'Surely I am coming soon.' Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all the saints. Amen." Our gospel lesson today is from John chapter 17, beginning with the 20th verse. "I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me, I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one, as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent them and have loved them, even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory, which you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them." And our sermon lesson today is from Luke chapter 24, beginning with the 44th verse. "Then he said to them, 'These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled.' Then he opened their minds to the understanding of the scriptures, and he said to them, 'Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from your high.' Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God."
States. This is Horse Memorial Day weekend. We know this primarily because of all the mattress sales that are taking place. Yes, apparently nothing says we remember like 40% off a queen size pillow top. For those of us who try to be a bit more thoughtful, we give God thanks for those brave souls who gave their lives in defense of our nation. And those of us in the church have something else to celebrate this weekend too. Today is Ascension Sunday, which is always the last Sunday in the season of Easter. Next Sunday will be Pentecost, the birthday of the church. Many of us will celebrate by reading together the story from Acts, where the believers are given the gift of the Holy Spirit, symbolized by fire in that great story. Some churches, like mine, even ask their parishioners to dress in the colors of fire, red, orange, yellow, to embody the story. And I know a few churches who will enjoy birthday cake in the fellowship hall after worship. Yes, Pentecost is a great celebration. But that's next week. Today is Ascension Sunday. This is the day we remember Jesus' ascension back into heaven after his earthly ministry was complete. When my older daughter, Ella, was young, she would often have trouble falling asleep. As you can imagine, the cause of her insomnia had to do with the darkness of her bedroom. But perhaps, unlike most children, in order for Ella to fall asleep, she required her room to be pitch black. And if it weren't, Ella would holler down the hallway, "Help! Help! The light is coming under my door!" Now, my younger daughter, Ashley, however, developed two things at the same time: a fear of the dark and an active imagination. Not a great combination, is it? She would imagine all sorts of scary things that could happen once the lights went out. The only way to guard against such things was to stay awake and keep lookout. Eventually, my wife or I would come and sit with her until she fell asleep. I remember on more than one occasion, Ashley just beginning to drift off, and then just jolted awake again, calling out, "Are you still there?" "Yes, honey, I'm still here. Please go to sleep." Letting go and saying goodbye is hard. Whether giving up a stuffed animal, moving beyond a childhood fear, saying goodbye is hard. I can't tell you how many times I've stood behind the pulpit for a memorial service or beside a freshly dug grave, and I thought to myself, "I really don't want to be here." Now, please don't get me wrong. I love being a pastor. I'm grateful that my church has invited me to stand alongside them at such difficult times. Times when we help to usher our loved ones through that sacred transition from this life to the next. Even though I'm honored to be present for that, the truth is, too often, I'm just not ready to say goodbye. My wife and I are preparing to say goodbye in a few months, as Ella, whom I just told you about, is headed to Wake Forest University as a freshman. We are incredibly excited for her, but saying goodbye is going to be rough. Over the past few years, due to this awful pandemic, each of us, we have had to say goodbye to vacations, weddings, seeing people's full faces, evenings out, in-person worship, careers, even. And most tragically, we have had to say goodbye to family and friends, behind masks, with 6 feet of distance, unable to share those hugs, handshakes, casseroles, and other healing rituals that we offer to one another. stands to reason that saying goodbye would get easier over time. At least I haven't found that to be the case. No, saying goodbye reminds us just how fragile life can be. Sometimes it causes us to wonder if we are truly alone in this world. Everything was about to change for the disciples. They had given up their careers and their families to follow Jesus. And they literally followed him, tagging along as he preached and taught, as he fed 5,000 people with a young boy's sack lunch, as he opened the eyes of the blind and turned the leper's skin clean. What's more, they had come to rely upon Jesus for everything. Then one day, he just left. As the Bible puts it, Jesus ascended into heaven. This event is what today, Ascension Sunday, asks us to remember. I imagine that as difficult as it was at times, being one of the first disciples of Jesus was wonderful too. Imagine having a front row seat to watching a paralyzed person brought before Jesus, only to see moments later that person rising from her mat and skipping all the way home. Imagine walking alongside Jesus after his resurrection, as people all over town began to recognize him, and then watching the looks on their faces as they realized what all this might mean. The disciples, surely they didn't want it to end. But it did. The way Luke tells it, Jesus lifted his hands to bless his disciples. And as he was blessing them, he was carried up into heaven. And then he was gone. Barbara Brown Taylor writes, Jesus disappeared, vanishing into the fog, like the end of a dream too good to be true. And in the book of Acts, which Luke writes as a sort of sequel to his gospel, Luke elaborates on the disciples' reaction. In the reading that accompanies today's lectionary reading, we see this. When Jesus had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two people in white robes stood by them. They said, "You Galileans, why do you stand looking up toward heaven?" In other words, quit looking up. Instead, start looking around. Start looking ahead. Start looking toward the work we know we must do. Friends, I believe it's important to recognize that Jesus didn't really leave his disciples that day. That is, he may have gone up. He has not gone away. Jesus departed from that one place so that he could be Christ in all places. He departed from them in that moment so he could be Christ for everyone and forever. And with the power Jesus promises them, he doesn't want his disciples and us to stare at heaven to which he just ascended. He wants us to look around us, to the needs and opportunities all around us, and get on with it, to continue the ministry he has taught us to do. And I believe this is as important now as it has ever been. Remembering the ascension of Jesus may be a timely blessing for us as we seek to claw our way out of this pandemic, as we grieve the war in the Ukraine, as we experience inflation, which is causing hardship on so many people. In the midst of all this, I believe we need to be reminded that Jesus has not left us. He may have gone up, but he has not gone away. Christ has not left us, and we have not been abandoned. Jesus has given us his love and his power and his presence to carry on in his name. And that is what we will do. Despite all the illness and death and pain and goodbyes all around us, we do not give up hope. We are still Christ's church, and this world needs the church now more than ever. In the name of Jesus Christ, we will continue the good work that we know how to do. Feed the hungry. Care for the poor. Pray for the sick. Weep with those who are grieving and love those who are dying. And I know that many people are so hard on the church these days. And I get it. Some of that criticism is warranted. But for those of us still in the church, working day in and day out to help her reflect the love and grace God has given us, we need to be reminded by the power of Christ's Spirit, God is still with us. We are still here, and we will be faithful. We have work to do. So today, on Ascension Sunday, let us lift our hearts and lift our voices, united in praise of the one who has promised never to abandon us and who walks with us every step of life's journey. And then, as we go forth, let us never forget that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead and then lifted him to heaven, that is the same power inside of us, enabling and empowering us to serve this world in Christ's name. And that is what we will do. May it be so. Amen.
Let us pray. For the children now gone, and the teachers now gone, for the parents, family, and friends who will spend the rest of their lives ever aching every night at the weight of this. For a schoolhouse rendered trauma-laden and grief-stricken in a matter of minutes. Those who will suffer in the wake of this tragedy. For the caregivers now burdened with the task of managing the shared and collective grief of a traumatized community who love their children. For those who feel the new burden of uselessness, guilt in the aftermath, wondering what else they could have done. For the nation, so in love with our weapons that we continue to tolerate these mass shootings and grief they inflict without ever building the collective will needed to address it fully. For the world, suffering a massive and collective grief of its own, and witnessing acts of cruelty daily, too numerous to fully process. Heal our gaping wounds. Restore our sense of compassion. Quiet the restlessness within us. Settle the building righteous anger. Quicken the desire for peace. Remove the chasm that sees race and religion and political persuasion as the marks of a person's worth and value. End the cycle of violence that begets more violence. Silence the voices that broker in fear the division and create the hatred we see mounting everywhere between us. Quiet the troubled soul thinking of grabbing the next gun and ending innocent lives. Empower us all to act, refusing to wait for the next horror show before we change the laws that make guns and their discharge so accessible. Turn anguish into action, our rage to restoration, our hatred to love, our grief to hope. Let it never happen again, ever. How much more can we bear, O Lord? How much more can we endure? Be our rock of refuge. Be our light of inspiration. Be our beacon of hope. Be the arms of love that hold us until the pain recedes. Lord in mercy, hear our prayers. And now we pray for Judy and Mark, Dottie, Dale, Joe and family, Morgan, Lois, Paul, Marlene and Jim, Chris, Shirley, Sandra, Wayne, Pat, Tina, Jim, Carol, Kay, Louise, Joanne and Dan, Katie, Pat, Tricia, Claire, Terry, Nala, Naomi, Debbie, Kay, Tim, Amy, Tim, George and Patty, Tim, Butch, Josh, Josephine, David, John, Shirley, Judy, Lance, the family of Barbara, the family of Bill, our church and congregation, everyone dealing with the coronavirus, and the people of the Ukraine. And we pray special prayers for the family and friends of those who were affected by the home explosion in Pottstown, as well as the family and friends of the people of Uvalde, Texas. And now we pray the prayer that you gave to us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever.
Thank you. Peace on earth, and let it be there.
there.